Matti Friedman has reported on Israel, Lebanon, Morocco, and Russia. His first book, The Aleppo Codex, which I heard one of you praising at the info desk not long ago, was named...
Only one?
I only heard one. Was named one of Booklist's top 10 books about religion the year it came out, and has been described over and over as history written so well it reads like a thriller. Pumpkinflowers, his new book, is an account of his time serving in the IDF in Lebanon, fighting what he describes as a forgotten little corner of a forgotten little war. It's part memoir, part journalism, part military history. It's already earned him comparisons to Philip Caputo, George Orwell, and in the New York Times, Tim O'Brien. He's in conversation tonight with Reuel Marc Gerecht, who's the author of three books about the contemporary Middle East, The Wave, Know Thine Enemy, and The Islamic Paradox. He's also a former spy. And now he's a contributing editor at the Weekly Standard and is a senior fellow at the Foundation for the Defense of Democracies. I'm going to turn the evening over to him, and please join me in welcoming them both.
Well, thank you very much. Is this on? Can you hear me? It's a pleasure to be in Politics and Prose. My daughter grew up downstairs, so it's always fun to be here. And it's also a great treat to be here with Matti. And I thought that maybe it would be a good idea just for Matti in the beginning to just give us a little background on who he is, so you can put into context my next question to him, which will be, why did he write this book?
First of all, thank you so much for coming. It's so nice to be back here. Actually, the first book event I ever did in my entire life was here 4 years ago when the Aleppo Codex came out. So it's great to be back here again. I was born in Toronto, which is in a nice country north of here. According to rumors I've heard, many Americans would like to hear more. I have a Canadian passport here in my coat, which I would be willing to part with for the right price. When I was 17, I finished high school and I went to Israel for a year. It was supposed to be a year on a kibbutz. That was in 1995, and I ended up staying. That was 21 years ago, and since then I've been in Israel. I decided that I was going to stay permanently and became a citizen, and when that happened, it triggered the draft, which is what happens. And in 1997, I went into the army and spent the regular, you know, three-year army service, and got out in 2000. And since then, I've been doing journalism for most of the years that have passed since then. That's the short version.
All right. Then the most important lead-off question then is, why did you write this book?
Why did I write this book? I kind of blundered into a strange little war, having come from a quiet neighborhood in Toronto. And I came to Israel with a fairly simple idea of what Israel was, which I think is fairly typical. And I was inducted in the summer of 1997 and found myself in Lebanon. And kind of strangely, I became an Israeli in Lebanon as part of this bizarre little war that was going on in those years just north of the Israeli border in a strip of land that we called the security zone. It was an occupied strip just north of the Israeli border that was designed to keep guerrillas with a U-E, from the Israeli border. And I ended up on this hill called the Pumpkin. We called it the Pumpkin. All of the Israeli outposts in Lebanon had these strange, perky bed and breakfast type names. So we were the Pumpkin. Next door was Outpost Citrus, and Outpost Red Pepper, and Cypress, Basil. Those were the names.
Why don't you tell them why they do that?
That's an excellent question. It's not entirely clear. I wrote an essay that came out in The Atlantic 2 weeks ago about military jargon and why Israeli soldiers use the euphemisms that they use and why Americans use the euphemisms that they use and British soldiers and Canadians. It's very interesting to look at a military through its jargon and then look at the society that sends that particular military and why the jargon is interesting. So Israel's military jargon is very floral. American military jargon tends to be quite aggressive. So you'll have, you know, weapon systems called Predator or Hellfire. There's nothing like that in Israel. Our weapon systems are called, for example, Artichoke. That's a night vision system for tank gunners. Artichoke. In Lebanon, we had a system that warned us of incoming mortar shells, and it was called Buttercup. That would not fly in the U.S. military, you know what I mean? So in the U.S. military, if you have a fatality, euphemisms that the soldiers use. You need euphemisms, right? Because you literally cannot describe the things that you see. So you need to be given a language that allows you not to describe them, to transmit information without actually describing what you see. So in the US military, you take KIA, which is kind of like a tax form, right? It's very bureaucratic. It's a bureaucratic acronym. The US military likes bureaucratic acronyms. In the Israeli military, the code word on the radio for casualties is flowers. So if you have casualties, you don't say we have wounded soldiers, you'd say we have flowers. And the code word for a fatality is oleander. Say we have an oleander. So the whole language of the Israeli military is very floral. So I kind of wandered into this strange botanical war in the late 90s and had these very intense and confusing experiences, which I've been trying to figure out basically since then. And coming out of the army in 2000, I developed this idea that I needed to go back to Lebanon as a civilian, which I recount in the book. And then I tried to write about it then, back then. I did a very poor job. And as the events of the 21st century unfolded, the American wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, and I watched I watched these events unfold, and they seemed so familiar to me as someone who had seen South Lebanon in the 90s, it led me back to those events in an attempt to kind of give what I think is a sort of prologue to the 21st century, or a prologue to the wars of the 21st century, because I think that I happen to see the first war of the 21st century, and that makes those experiences more relevant than they would be otherwise.
I mean, do you think, is that the theme of the book? Because, I mean, the book is overwhelmingly a book chronicle of a soldier at war. And, I mean, it's not a criticism of war books at all. They are all dark by nature. Most of your book, when it's quite witty at times, but it is also dark. Sometimes I felt the theme was, in fact, you've put it at the end because the meat of the book is really about the life of a soldier and trying to make sense of the darkness.
Yes, I mean, I think that's true. What I said is kind of the political backdrop to the book, but that's what it is. It's a backdrop. That's actually not what's of most of interest to me. What's of interest to me is the movement of little human figures against the backdrop of great events on planet Earth. So the book is really about what happens to very young men who finish high school and then are thrown into circumstances that are very extreme and very interesting, and how they deal with it, how they think about it. Some of the characters in the book are people I know who served with me. Some of the characters in the book are people who I found just by kind of going around Israel, and one phone number led to another, and I found guys who had served at this hill, at the Pumpkin, at different times. Some of the characters survive and some of them don't, but it's a profile of members of a generation of Israelis about whom I think very little is known. And I thought that was important. I wanted to say something about Israelis now, and I wanted the names of the fallen from this forgotten war to be written down, and I wanted their stories written down.
Why is this generation of Israelis not as well known?
I think that when people talk about Israel here, when they speak about Israel in English, there's still the writing about Israel's history in English is stuck somewhere around the Entebbe raid in the 70s. And when you talk about Israel here, you hear a lot about Golda Meir and Moshe Dayan and the kind of greatest hits reel of the early years of Israel, which I understand were very exciting, and I'm kind of sorry to have missed them. But if you want to understand Israel in 2016, the writing has to move on. The people who are shaping Israel right now had nothing to do with any of the names or events that I mentioned. And for Israelis now, as I say in the book, for the kids who are with me at this outpost, Ben Gurion and Herzl were streets. That's what they were. The country now is more complicated. The defining event or the defining experience for many Israelis my age was this little war in Lebanon that no one talks about even in Israel. There's very little writing about it even in Hebrew. So I think that if we want to understand where Israel is now, beyond the absurd caricature of the country that's often put forward, negative caricature or positive caricature, but often you're just getting a caricature of what is a very complicated little place. And if we want to move beyond the caricature and kind of get at the very complicated and surprisingly resilient and fascinating soul of the country, we need to understand this and kind of move the writing ahead a bit.
When you talk about that there really hasn't been that much writing in Israel about the Lebanon experience, and you're talking from the invasion of 82 forward?
That's a great question. The Lebanon experience is so long that we need to really specify what we're talking about. The invasion of Lebanon in 1982 has been written about extensively. That is what is called the Lebanon War in Israel. When we say Lebanon War, that war officially ended a short time after the invasion. As far as official Israel is concerned, nothing happened after that. So the writing about it peters out around 83, 84. And you might think that the army had actually withdrawn from Lebanon. But in fact, the army stayed in Lebanon for another decade and a half. And that decade and a half, which we call the security zone, doesn't have a name. There's no official name for it. There's no military ribbon. It's not officially recognized as something that happened. So if you're trying to figure out, for example, the number of fatalities in this strange war in South Lebanon, it's very difficult to do so because the army doesn't recognize that it happened. It's not a thing that happened. There's no monument to the fallen in South Lebanon. It was just something going on the border, on the periphery of people's attention, that people in Israel didn't think was particularly important when it was going on. In the 90s, what everyone thought was important was the peace process. So if you look at newspapers, everyone's talking about that. And this little affair was, you know, below the fold or in the, you know, on page 4 or 5. Ultimately, the peace process, unfortunately, turns out to have been far less important than this.
Why don't you explain that more?
Well, I think that in the 90s, many of us, certainly me, hope that that we were watching the creation of a new Middle East, if you remember that term, new Middle East. The new Middle East was supposed to replace war and conflict with trade, and people were going to come from Baghdad to the beach in Tel Aviv, and we were going to go to Damascus to shop in the Shuk in Damascus. And of course, there would be a Palestinian state, a democratic Palestinian state, and that is the direction that the Middle East was going in as far as I knew in the 1990s. That's what people meant when they said the new Middle East. I think that ultimately I witnessed the birth of the real new Middle East. And it didn't happen around negotiating tables. And in retrospect, that was just, you know, tragically and unfortunately for us, that was really just a flash in the pan. It might have just been a fantasy that some of us had. The new Middle East was born in South Lebanon. And it was these new tactics of warfare, the IED, the suicide bomber, which appears in South Lebanon, videotaped attacks, and ideologies that seem kind of crazy to people in the West, that seem to have very different goals from any that we can understand. In the 90s, this looked like the end of the old Middle East. It was the end of something bad, and what was coming was better, so no one paid attention to it. But I think from 2016, it's pretty clear that this was the beginning of something that is still playing out, and we might still be in the beginning right now.
If you were to compare, say, the Israelis in the West Bank, the Israelis in Lebanon, obviously the Israelis in the West Bank, there's a real closeness between the Israelis and the Palestinians. The proximity is there. You have, and that's true through the army, through the security services, and also the Israelis who live on the West Bank. Could you describe what it was like for Israeli soldiers and at the bases in Lebanon? How much contact, other than when people were trying to kill them, did they have with the Lebanese Shia?
Very, very little. We on our hill, which is about 5 miles north of the border, we had no contact with anyone. We were just in this little compound, which was about the size of a basketball court. It was earth embankments in a rectangle around a courtyard, and there were bunkers where we slept. And we manned guard posts on the four corners of the outpost, and we would leave the outpost on occasion at night to do ambushes, and that was that. Anyone around the hill, anyone in fire zone around the hill who wasn't us was supposed to be shot. Those were our instructions, which is a pretty easy to understand battlefield by 21st century standards. Things are usually much more murky if you're a U.S. soldier in Iraq or Afghanistan, or an Israeli soldier in the West Bank. It's hard to know. But our situation was quite clear. We had no contact with civilians. The only Lebanese who we interacted with were members of our allied militia. There was an allied militia in South Lebanon called the South Lebanon Army, which was led by Christians, but staffed in large part by the end by soldiers who were Shiites and Druze. And we did interact with them, and the interactions there were, I think, quite similar to the interactions between American troops and their Iraqi allies or their Afghan allies, which is a kind of suspicious and confused interaction between two organizations who are officially on the same side, but who actually have a kind of more complicated and less happy kind of relationship. But other than that, we saw no civilians at all.
When you arrived there, if you look back and you say, all right, what was my tactical and strategic understanding of why I was there risking my life? Did that change while you were there?
I had the benefit of being 19 and pretty dumb, which is, which is a good idea if you're in the army. My concept of what was going on was very, very simple. In every outpost in South Lebanon, there was a sign that said the mission, defense of the northern communities. That was the mission. The idea was that we were blocking the way. We were standing between the guerrillas and the border. And it made sense to me because from the pumpkin, I could look south from our hill and over about 5 miles of hostile territory, I could see the northernmost houses in Israel. Matula is the northernmost settlement in Israel, and I could see white houses in Matula. And it made sense to me. I could see the houses, I could see the bad guys. It made perfect sense. In retrospect, it was exponentially more complicated than that. And the contradictions of the security zone became increasingly apparent as the 90s wore on and ended ultimately in the withdrawal from Lebanon in 2000, when the Israeli public turned against the Lebanon idea and kind of gave up. And the pumpkin was blown up by my unit, and all the other outposts with their pretty names were also blown up on the same night, and the whole Lebanon enterprise kind of came to an end, an abrupt end.
I mean, if you had to describe why the Israelis gave up on Lebanon, what would that be? Because you certainly suggest by the end of the book that the strategic threat is the same, if not greater. So is that appreciation really a minority view in Israel, or could that change overnight depending upon how many missiles come down?
About the wisdom of the withdrawal. In the 90s, the thinking was, not just in Israel, by the way, but elsewhere, that if you create a vacuum, then something good will fill it. So that was the peace process idea. You create a vacuum in the West Bank or Gaza, and something good fills that vacuum. If we pull back in South Lebanon, something better will fill that vacuum and we'll have peace along that border. We understood Hezbollah as a kind of Viet Cong-like organization, that is an ideological organization that wanted to liberate a piece of land. And they kind of had a point, right? We were on their territory. It made sense to me. I didn't think it was mine. I didn't think I had any claim to that hilltop. And it made sense to me that if we gave back their land, we would have peace along the border. It turns out that the Middle East doesn't work that way. And that when organizations like Hezbollah or like Hamas speak in this language that is very difficult for Westerners to understand, a language of holy war, religious war, generational conflict, maybe perpetual conflict, Westerners have a tendency to dismiss it as kind of rhetoric, an attempt to talk to the base, but that masks actually rational ideas and rational goals, but they mean what they say. And that's the lesson of the last decade and a half in the Middle East.
You haven't gotten a chance yet to have really an Israeli reception to this book, right?
Right. It'll come out in Hebrew around the end of the summer, and it'll be interesting to see what people think about it.
If you had to guess now, what do you think the Israeli reception to the book will be?
Well, I think that for many Israelis, this experience is kind of like a black box. The soldiers who came out of Lebanon in the 90s never saw a reflection of the importance of that experience in the mainstream culture. So if you came back from fighting a real war, like the Six-Day War, or the Yom Kippur War, your society told you that what you'd experienced was important, gave it a name, it asked you about it, books were written about it, but the guys from Lebanon came back to a country that really wasn't that interested in what had happened, and this might be the first time that most of them have had an indication that what happened was actually important.
And was the service in Lebanon, was that more selective than, say, the service in the West Bank?
Yes, the units inside Lebanon that were sent to the outposts that were far from the Israeli border were more elite units. So the army didn't use the regular battalions in the most, the outposts that were farthest in, and crucially, they didn't use reserves. So most of the Israeli army is reservists, and reserve units are very unruly and kind of democratic, and no one follows orders, and everyone's always complaining. And so if you use reservists, then they come home from their month in reserves, and they write a letter to a member of parliament, or they publish an article, they write a book about it. The army didn't use reservists in South Lebanon in the 90s, and that's one of, perhaps for that reason, and that's one of the reasons that this experience was it was a kingdom of 19-year-olds. There were no adults. The commander of our outpost, you know, was 22 or something like that. And it made it very, made
that's
it very,
never good.
It made, well, yeah, probably not. 22 seemed really old to me at the time. I want to ask you a question. My experience in Lebanon, was really my first contact with the Middle East outside of Israel, and I found myself in these guard posts just looking at this beautiful, beautiful, beautiful country, just green slopes and the Litani River kind of running to the Mediterranean and Mount Hermon in the distance, and it was dangerous and exciting, and I kind of loved it, which I hope comes across in the book. I kind of loved it, and I kind of still love it, and ever since I had that experience, I've been trying to unpack it and trying to understand it, and many of my friends from the outpost had the same reaction. So one of my buddies from my platoon now has a doctorate in the modern history of Lebanon, and a lot of other people who were there kind of have this lingering positive connection to the Middle East. And I was wondering if you, having also looked at the Middle East for so long, not through a literal gun sight perhaps, but through a metaphorical gun sight, I wonder if you came to love the region, or if you have more complicated feelings about it.
I think it's much easier to fall in love with someplace which is pretty than to fall in place someplace which is ugly.
Iran's beautiful as far as
no, I mean, but I mean, for example, it would be hard for me to get nostalgic about southern Iraq, since it's just an extensive mud flat. Also, Iraqis aren't that humorous. Lebanese are more humorous.
So we weren't seeing their humorous side.
No, you were not obviously seeing the funny side.
Though I did later on.
Yeah. I mean, I have to say, I, at the end of the book, it's very touching. Matty goes back to Lebanon using his Canadian passport, and actually goes to visit a restaurant which he had been passing all the time as a soldier. And while he was a soldier, he was dreaming of how wonderful the restaurant would be, and then he arrives back there after he's out of the army, and he finds out that the restaurant sucks. Which
it's a life lesson there
which,
for
yeah,
you.
Which also is a very Middle Eastern experience, that you know, you often go to places that you've been reading about and dreaming about, and you get there and you discover that in fact your initial reaction to it is dysentery. it can hit you now. And with that said, I would say that Afghanistan is, for example, exquisite. You will get sick, more sick than you could possibly imagine when you go there, but you walk away from that experience still wanting to go back to Afghanistan, which is not, you know, the reaction you have to Iraq. I don't know. I mean, I've always thought I fell in love with the Middle East quite early, first by books and then by visits. I think it's not uncommon for Jews, for example, to fall in love with the Middle East because of not just the historical connection, but also because the Islamic world isn't Christian. So it draws you in because you're looking at someone else looking at Christianity from the outside. And that has been a common experience, for example, of all many of the great scholars of Islamic history, who were a sizable number of them were, of course, as we all know, Jewish in the 19th and early 20th century. So I've always thought it was the contradiction, it was the contrast. It just sort of grabs a hold of you. And also the warmth. You don't get to experience that if you're being shot at. But what's also funny about the Middle East is you can be shot at, and then you can experience the warmth immediately thereafter. So it's quite fluid.
Yes.
If you look back at it, if you were to criticize your young self, what did you get wrong when you were looking at your experience when you were young?
I think I thought that things were simple, and I thought that that we were in control. It was hard for me then to understand the Middle East as a kind of regional conflict with dozens of players, dozens of actors, and I think many people still have that problem. So we still tend to talk about an Israeli-Palestinian conflict. Here I saw an Israeli Hezbollah conflict, but that's actually not a helpful way to understand the Middle East. It won't get you very far. The way to understand the Middle East is as this vast region in conflict with itself, with dozens of players, Hezbollah and Israel being two of them, the Palestinians being another, different factions among the Palestinians, Americans, Kurds, Russians, ISIS, Jabhat al-Nusra, the Iranians, and the Kurds, and you can go on and on. And of course, when I was 19 or 20, I couldn't possibly have understood that. Things seemed to me to be quite simple, and I thought that if we, I thought that we could withdraw or reason our way out of our predicament, both in Lebanon and in our predicament with the Palestinians. And it turns out to be more complicated than that. Israel's a very small country in a corner of the region, and we can be smart or we can be stupid, and I think we're both. But it doesn't revolutionize our existence in the Middle East. Interestingly, the beginning of the Lebanon enterprise and the peace process of the 1990s, which are very different enterprises, were kind of the same idea. Both were dramatic attempts to revolutionize Israel's situation in the Middle East. The 82 invasion of Lebanon was supposed to install a friendly government in Lebanon that would make peace with Israel. And that, of course, goes badly awry, in a kind of eerie precursor to American adventures of similar nature. And the peace process idea in the 1990s is that we revolutionize our situation in the Middle East, not by military action, but by political compromise. And then it turned out that that also doesn't work. So we're left with an Israel today that I think is very, very tough and more resilient than you'd expect, but certainly with a sense of constricted horizons and a very limited possibilities compared to the Israel that I moved to in 1995.
I'm going to ask one more question, then I'll turn it over to questions of the audience. I mean, if you were to actually imagine that you'd been serving with Canadians, young Canadians in Lebanon, and not young Israelis, do you think that experience would have been any different? And I ask that because you said this generation of Israelis is different from the older generation of Israelis. So if you could somehow answer my tendentious question, keeping that in mind.
Without insulting Canadians.
Yes. Never insult Canada.
No. No, especially not now when you need them on your side. You want that border nice and open on November 8th. I think that Israeli kids, even in this generation, which is kind of a not particularly ideological generation, certainly compared to the to the Israel of the popular imagination, the kibbutz and the palmach, and this Israel that lives on in the Western imagination, even though it's long gone in Israel, Israeli kids are more interesting and aware than their counterparts in Canada, not in America. Because America, no, I'm just kidding. In Israel, the country forces you to come to terms with it quite early. I'm just thinking about my own kids. I have three. I have 2 9-year-olds and a 5-year-old, and we live in Jerusalem. So they're constantly being challenged by their landscape. For example, yesterday was Memorial Day in Israel. Siren goes off in Israel. The entire country stops. Have you ever? Many of you might have. Must have seen it. The entire country stops. Buses stop on the highway. Everyone stops in the mall. My daughter in her kindergarten, it just stops. Everyone stops. And the kids then ask, why are we stopping? What's going on? And you explain to them about a war and soldiers. They get the Holocaust pretty early. We hear the muezzin. We live close to a number of Arab neighborhoods, and we hear the muezzin all the time. What's that? They know about Islam. We pass churches in the old city. What's Christianity? You have to explain to them what Christianity is. My kids think Christianity is like an obscure sect that we're in charge of, like the Druze.
Well, once upon, historically, that's not that far from the truth.
They'll figure it out eventually, but I haven't told them. But basically what I mean is that as an Israeli, pretty young, you have to grapple with stuff. You have to make decisions about the army. The army's looming pretty soon in high school. And you just can't ignore the country. It forces you to think about it. So by the time Israeli kids turn 18, 19, a lot of them have had deep thoughts about stuff. Some of them come from religious homes and have a lot of Bible and a lot of tradition in their head. And that, I think, makes a cohort of 19-year-old Israelis at Outpost Pumpkin more interesting than their parallel cohort in back in Toronto or wherever.
I would add that Maddie's vivid descriptions of being at Pumpkin, it did tell me one thing for sure, and that is, it was a really good idea that Israeli female soldiers were not there at that base camp with you.
Yes, there were no women allowed in past the border inside Lebanon, so it was all male. And as you can imagine, we were maybe 50, 18 to 21-year-olds trapped on this hill for weeks and weeks and weeks. Sometimes on the radio, as I say, you would hear a female voice. There were women soldiers at the bases down in Israel who were running the war rooms, and occasionally you'd hear them on the radio, and you could hear kind of throats clench across the security zone just from their voices. Such was our deprivation in those days.
Longing. All right, I'm going to throw it over for questions. So by all means, stick your hands in the air, and I will try to get to everyone.
There are microphones on the sides, right?
Right there. Sorry, I didn't see that.
Why do you think the peace process fell apart in 2000? And could Arafat have accepted the offer, or at least counteroffered? And what's the prospects of a two-state solution now?
This should only take 5 or 6 hours, so just bear with me.
I tried to keep it narrow. I have more.
I think that looking broadly at the Middle East in the 1990s, the pendulum was swinging in a direction different than the way we thought it was swinging. We thought it was going toward Western style compromise and maybe democracy or more freer, more peaceful Middle East. I kind of counted on it. I certainly voted for it in those days. But if you look at Lebanon, and not just Lebanon, if you look at Iran, which is where Reuel had his eyes trained in those years, and across the Middle East, you see that the religious war idea was stirring across the Middle East throughout the 1990s. Hamas was stirring. Al-Qaeda was stirring, right, in 1993. This book opens in 1994 with an attack on the pumpkin, but in 1993, the World Trade Center was bombed in an attack that was largely seen as a curiosity. The region was moving somewhere else. It was moving somewhere else. Everyone was looking in one place. Everyone was looking at the negotiating table, but something else was going on under the surface. And in 2000, which seems cosmic, right, because it's the beginning of a new millennium, but in 2000, it goes boom. Israel pulls out of South Lebanon, Hezbollah takes over South Lebanon, the second intifada starts that fall, the peace process falls apart, the next year, the World Trade Center, then Iraq and Afghanistan, and the thing starts rolling. So I think it's bigger than the details of a particular offer from Israel to the Palestinians is much bigger than Israel and the Palestinians, in my opinion.
I might just add quickly that when I entered the Directorate of Operations in 1985, there was this teeny little office that was actually over on the DI side, the analytical wing. And those folks dealt with questions surrounding Islam, God, militancy. I mean, that was it. It was teeny office. If you attempted to look at, if you looked at cable traffic coming out of the agency or telegrams from the State Department, I'm pretty sure it's even true today, you would find references to religion, faith, to be quite rare, even when the cable traffic was only on the Islamic Republic. It's just not the way Americans look at things. And to use a shorthand, as the, for very understandable reason, as the Islamic identity goes up, the chances of a two-state solution go down. It's just a simple equation.
If you might not know, by the way, but you won't say it about yourself, so I'll say it. Reuel wrote an article talking about the fact that American intelligence has no idea what Al-Qaeda's up to, has almost no one on the ground, has almost no Arabic or Farsi speakers, doesn't have the capability to get agents inside any of these organizations, and he wrote it. It's in The Atlantic. You can Google it and find it. It was published in August 2001.
Sometimes you're lucky.
That's not funny.
It wasn't luck.
Thank
it
you.
Wasn't luck. It's the one article. If you write one article like that, you retire because you've done it. That's, you know, more than enough.
Yeah, I just had a question talking about religion and religious motivations. Do you have any idea whether your presence there was perceived as motivated by religion?
That's an interesting question. It's quite possible that it was. If you see the world as our opponents did through a religious worldview, then it's quite possible that yes. I mean, for example, if you look at Hezbollah literature, they often don't say Israel, they say Jews. So it's about Jews. The deputy secretary general of Hezbollah wrote a book which came out in English and is fascinating. I don't know if you have it at Politics and Prose. It's probably not a big seller. It's called Hezbollah, The Story from Within. And in this book, he speaks about Israel in a way that's very theological. And he quotes Islamic traditions that say the Jews controlled the land once and were driven out by God because they disappointed God. And they're in the land again, and they will be driven out again. And the first time it was the Romans who were the tool of God, God's anger, and now it's Hezbollah. That's the implication of what he was writing. So yes, I think that they see things in terms that are very religious. When people in the West, as Reuel was saying, think about, you know, things like GDP and the government and president and things like that, we have failed to understand, because so many people in the West are distant from religion, we fail to understand the way we ourselves are perceived in this religious script. Interestingly, it's not something that's that hard to explain to Americans, for example, from a faith background. So I've had a chance to speak to people who come from homes where the Bible was important, people who believe, people who also see life through their faith. It makes perfect sense to them. You know, I say this is the way they read their scripture. Yep, that makes sense. It's harder for us, or for people whose worldview has been shaped by different ideas and by secularism. It's harder for us to wrap our head around it.
Oh, I guess
it's all yours.
Is it on? Okay. I have a few corollaries. That might be the wrong word, but
use it.
You probably know what I'm searching for. Okay, so. I'm not going to look at whatever, but I was wondering, like, you speak of generations. I'm wondering, like, how old you are now, and as well as kind of the where you approach your story from, like, whether you have any, I'm not trying to, you know, delve into your personal politics, but, like, what organization, not, like, the idea organization, yeah. You view this, your work writing this and serving in this campaign or whatever, sorry, I shouldn't say whatever, but
do Do you want me to start from the beginning?
Like how it relates to like organizationally, like that idea to what was represented through your experience. And the other thing I wanted to ask is if you view any relationship to your experience to something like Black Lives Matter or the idea of these military relationships or the relationship with the military as to anything that to like the sort of things that Ta-Nehisi Coates describes with Black Lives in this republic, democracy, whatever it is.
Right. I'm 38. And just so you don't have to guess about my politics, I'm on the left in Israel, just so you don't have to guess. The book, if I'm understanding the question correctly, is written in a journalistic capacity. So it's not trying to sell you anything except an explanation of what's going on. I think that
I meant it in terms of the idea of organization, not like organization, like organizing, mm-hmm. you know, like what you're in relationship to structurally. Not necessarily anything that even exists outside of you.
Well, I mean, I think that if I can try to approach the question, I'm a journalist, right? So I'm just trying to get as close to an accurate and deep portrayal of events as I can. As for the second part of the question, I think it's a mistake for Americans to draw parallels that are too close between their country and Israel. Israel's a very different country, and I think one of the problems with the kind of crazed debate about Israel in America on all sides is that a lot of people in America seem to think that Israel is kind of a version of America or an extension of America. And part of the confusion is people like me, right? Because I sound Canadian or American, and a lot of the people, you know, our ambassador happens to be a former American, and so was our former ambassador and our prime minister. You know, grew up in Philadelphia and went to MIT. This contributes to a confusion about what Israel is. Israel is a foreign country. It's a tiny foreign country in the Middle East. Most of Israel's population is Middle Eastern in origin. Right. So Israel has a 20% Arab minority. Of the Jews in Israel, the 80% Jewish majority, half come from the Middle East. Their origins are in the Middle East. And that makes them very different, not only from the population of the United States, but from the Jewish population of the United States, which is overwhelmingly of East European descent. It's a very different place. And if people are imagining a simple kind of parallel between race issues in America and the Israeli-Palestinian thing, it's a big mistake, and it won't get you very far in terms of understanding what's actually going on. It's very, very different. I'm not saying it's necessarily better or worse. I'm just saying it's completely different and needs to be understood in a completely different with a completely different set of assumptions. Yeah.
When you became an Israeli citizen, you must have known, at least I hope that you knew, that you were going to be serving in the Israeli
yes.
army. And when you went in, what did you know or what did you expect you were going to experience, and how did the experience that you actually had comport with those expectations? What did you think coming out versus when you went in?
Well, when I decided that I was staying in Israel and I understood that this meant that I was going to do military service, I had to tell my parents. And my dad, I grew up in Toronto, but my dad's actually an American from New York, a Vietnam era American, with all of those pictures in his head. He was kind of worried. So I said, don't worry. I'm going to go to the Navy. Israel has a very small Navy that just kind of sails up and down the Mediterranean. I kind of thought it was more like Baywatch than combat. I was like, don't really have nothing to worry about. I'm just going to go to the Navy. And he thought that sounded okay. And I went to the induction center as I did my draft process. And they looked at me and I said, I want to go to the Navy. And they kind of smiled at me and they sent me to the infantry for 3 years. What was I expecting? I don't know. It's hard to remember how little you once knew. I'd read a lot. But all the wrong stuff, so I didn't know quite what to expect, certainly whatever I expected, it wasn't what I found. It wasn't like, you know, war movies. It wasn't like war books. It was just a very confusing and diffuse experience, which turns out to be the way wars work now. No one's, you know, storming Normandy. It's just this long, drawn out thing where 99% of the time you're bored out of your mind, and then 1% of the time you're absolutely terrified, and you can't quite get a handle on what's going on, and you're kind of born this way and that on tides that you barely understand as a young person. That seemed to me to be a unique experience at the time, but, you know, tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of Americans have had a similar experience since then.
My impression is that Israeli Jews, unlike American Jews, a lot of them speak Arabic.
And, not enough of them.
But why didn't you have, couldn't you have more contact with the farmers and the village people and things like
that? When we were in Lebanon.
Yeah.
Well, we were in a war situation. We were at an outpost. We were afraid of dying. We didn't know when we saw, for example, shepherds. Shepherds used to move with their flocks not far away from the outpost. A lot of the shepherds were Hezbollah scouts, and that were trying to gauge our sight lines to see what we could see and what we couldn't see. We never knew if we passed a car on a convoy going in, if we passed a civilian car, if that car was going to blow up on the convoy. We never knew when we saw a boulder alongside the road, if it was a boulder or if it was an IED. So the landscape to us was threatening, and everything seemed threatening, even people who were completely innocent, and were just going about their business. Everything kind of seemed ominous. So it wasn't, you know, we weren't in a position to develop friendly relations with anyone.
The Israelis weren't doing a counterinsurgency. I mean, it wasn't an Iraqi experience.
That's right.
Where we were actually in Iraq, 2007, 2008, into 2009, we were trying to establish protective zones so the denizens could live without fear. The Israelis were not doing that. They were trying to establish a barricade, you might say.
That's right. That's right.
Must be more questions.
So I'm halfway through the book, and I'm enjoying it very much. So I recommend it highly to everyone here. So my first question, wearing your author hat, why did it take you a full 2 decades to publish?
That's a great question.
And then wearing your journalist hat and, you know, your political hat, maybe you could talk a little bit about the growing gulf that we're hearing about seemingly between the IDF brass and the political leadership in Israel.
Thank you for those questions. As I said, I made an early attempt to write about it. I tried to write about it in beginning about 2002, and the result was I now understand pretty bad. I didn't have any perspective on what I had seen, and I was very self-centered. So I told a pretty narcissistic blinkered version of what had happened, and it didn't go anywhere. That manuscript didn't go anywhere, and I put it aside. I basically gave up on it, and I went off to do other things, and I became a journalist, and I wrote articles and went up all over the place as a reporter, and I published another book, and then went back to these experiences, and this time I could make sense of them, because I had seen 15 years go by in the Middle East. I understood that this was more important than I had initially thought. I understood that I'm not important in the story. I just happened to see something that was interesting, and my role in this manuscript changed. It's not, I'm in it, and it's part of it's written in the first person, but it's not really about me, even the parts that I'm in.
Did you read another book that helped you to see
how to do that, you mean?
Yeah.
Yes, and it's connected to the answer to the question, actually. If you look at the books that came out of the Great War, the First World War, that's what I was reading much of the time when I was writing this book. And you notice something interesting. The memorable books that came out of that war started to appear about a decade after the war was over. The ones that we remember, Goodbye to All That, Undertones of War, Siegfried Sassoon's trilogy, and others. There was about a 10-year lag while these guys put their heads in order. They didn't just get back from the front and start cranking out beautiful fiction about it. It had to sink in. They had to calm down. Edmund Blunden, who wrote this book called Undertones of War, which is one of the classics from the First World War, writes in his introduction, "I came back from the war. I tried to write about it, and it was bad, and I put it aside." The things they carried came out quite a long time after the Vietnam War. So I think it's common. I didn't understand that at the time. I was frustrated that I couldn't do anything with that early manuscript. It makes sense. This kind of thing, it takes time. It's a kind of countercultural in the age of the tweet, but it's it just needs to mature, and you need to think about it, and you need to forget a lot of stuff that's unimportant. When you come out of the army, you've got a lot of jumbled information in your head. You think acronyms and names of weapons are very important. You think names of units are very important. You think names of operations are very important. You have a lot of technical information in your head, and if you read some of the stuff coming out of Iraq and Afghanistan, you'll see a lot of that still in there, and I don't think it's very interesting. It doesn't matter what your gun is called. Who cares what your gun is called? It's a gun. And that kind of stuff falls by the wayside as time goes on. An extreme example of the way this works is maybe the best war book I've ever read, but I read it in Hebrew. So I don't know if this is going to be a useful recommendation, although it has been translated into English. It's a book called Tashach, in Hebrew, in English, 1948, written by an author named Yoram Kaniok. And he joined the Palmach when he was 17 and fought in the 1948 war. And it took him 60 years to write the perfect, short, concise book about that war, shorn of absolutely anything unnecessary. It's just the heart of the experience, and it took him 6 years to do it. And now I've managed to forget the second part of your question. About the gulf between, there are tensions in Israel. I think they're kind of overblown. Just because everything in Israel happens at such high volume, everyone's shouting and everything, it's always the apocalypse. And so we get that in Israel, you get it, it's always the apocalypse. So just, you know, but it's, when it's translated for people abroad, it seems, everything seems worse than it actually is, because everything happens at such high decibels in Israel. And then it doesn't, it doesn't translate that well. But there are certainly, there's, The army brass in Israel has traditionally been, if not left wing, then center left. That's the military. That's where the weight of military of the brass. That's where they've always been. And of course, we have a government now that's includes a lot of people who are quite stridently right, and kind of into provocations and kind of rabble rousing in a way that might seem familiar to I hear some rabble has been roused in this part of the world as well. So that's what you're hearing, and it's worrisome. I'm not happy about it as an Israeli, but it's not, you know, civil war in Israel is not nigh. It's just a country that operates at this very high volume, which is something that you learn when you start looking at old newspapers, which I've been doing a lot of, both for this book and for the new book that I'm writing right now. Look at old newspapers from the 40s and 50s or 90s in this case, and you see that it has always been like this. And it's always, you know, it's either disaster, it's catastrophe, or it's, you know, heaven. It's the Six-Day War, or it's the beginning of the 73 war. It's like the country's completely bipolar, and you have to take everything with a grain of salt.
This is
going to
be our last question.
So not too long ago, you got a lot of attention in your critique of how the world media covers Israel and they're sort of narrow-minded and follow a single path. I'm curious what has happened from that, and what's the after story, and in particular, to what degree in your conversations with individual journalists have they seen things in any different way?
Sure, I'll just explain briefly, and I'll try to keep the answer brief. I wrote two essays in the fall of 2014 critiquing the Israel story, which is the kind of the guidelines of the coverage of Israel followed by most mainstream news outlets. I was a correspondent for the AP for 5.5 years in Israel, and it's based on my experiences. It ties into the book, I think, because this book is an attempt to tell what I think is the correct way to understand the country, which doesn't mean that I think everything's great. It's not it's not a matter of positive or negative as much as it is a complicated story versus a simple story. And I think that the story that people get here and in the West in general about Israel is, as I said, a caricature of what's going on. You can't understand Israel's predicament in a 600-word news story. and you can't understand it in a 90-second TV spot. So you end up getting a very simple version of what's going on, a story framed as an Israeli-Palestinian conflict when it isn't an Israeli-Palestinian conflict. It's a regional conflict. It's framed as a conflict that began in 1967 when it did not begin in 1967. It began at least in the 20s, and the Palestine Liberation Organization was founded in 1964, 3 years before the occupation started. So clearly the conflict is much more complicated than as it is described. So those essays were an attempt to explain that people need to kind of listen less to the simple story that they're getting even from trustworthy media sources like the one I worked for, and try to see the country in its complexity and try to understand its true predicament. Has it had a massive effect on media coverage of Israel? No, it has not. I got some, let's just say the opposition to those essays from inside the press corps was very loud, and the support was very discreet, but there was support. A lot of people understand that there's a problem. I noted, for example, that in 2006, when I started to work for the AP, the number of reporters we had covering the Israel story, which is more than 40, was more than the number of reporters we had covering China, for example. Israel's a country on 1/100 of 1% of the world's surface. There's more reporters than we had covering India, which is a billion people and change. There's more reporters than we had covering all of sub-Saharan Africa, which is about 50-something countries. So those are objective numbers, and I'm not the only one who notices that that's a bit weird. But it's hard to kind of shift the zeitgeist in the press, which is part of a general zeitgeist in the West. It's kind of like an aircraft carrier that's kind of sailing in one direction. It doesn't turn easily.
As a journalist, how would you communicate the complicated distinctions that are part of life in Israel that most people have no clue about?
Well, that's what I'm trying to do. That's what I'm trying to do, and it can't be done in a news story, and it can't be done in a YouTube video, and it can't be done in a tweet. It can only be done through something like this, or by actually visiting the country in question. And I think if you come and see the country, you get it. You know, I'm not saying that everything's great by any means, but the true situation of Israel and the real predicament facing Israel and the real options facing Israel, I think, become apparent when you're there, and they're very hard to see from far away. The new book is about one of Israel's first spies. That's the very short elevator pitch. That's the elevator pitch from, like, you know, floor one to floor two.
Did he live or die?
He is still alive. He's 92. He's 92, and it's a way into what I think is one of the most important things that everyone needs to know about Israel now, which is, as I mentioned, that half of the Jews in Israel had nothing to do with Herzl or socialism or the kibbutz or the Holocaust. They come from the Middle East. They come from places like Aleppo. In Baghdad, where they'd been basically forever. So this spy who no one's heard of, he's not famous. He comes from an Arab city. He's from Aleppo. He's a native Arabic speaker, and he spent the first 2 years of Israel's existence living as a Palestinian refugee in Beirut. And it's an interesting way to look at the murky identity questions for those for the Jewish population of Israel that comes from the Middle East. Who are they exactly? Where do they fit in the story? And it certainly helps scramble the caricature, the binary story about Jews and Arabs and Israelis and Palestinians. It's much, much more complicated than that.
I think it's good to end on the idea that it's best to read books and not tweet.
Thank you so much for coming. It was a real pleasure.
Thanks.